Good evening, everyone. Who have I got? Okay, now you all hear me okay? Hoping this microphone's working.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Excellent. One will do.
Morning.
Yep.
Is it good morning somewhere? It's always beer o'clock somewhere in the world. I'm just recording this too. There's a couple of people who wanted to watch it. So, yeah, no swearing.
Hello, Carl.
Good evening, Ben. I think that's Ben anyway. It's a bit hard to tell when it's just your voice, but it's all good. That's the one we want. Chaos and Faceoffs. Excellent. So it makes sense. Upside down, Miss Jane. Oh, that didn't work either. Start again. That's just dumb. Rotate left will work better. There we go. That's almost useful. Sorry, I'm just getting rink shares ready so that we can kind of see. We'll give everyone like another minute or two just to see if anyone else sticks their head in, then we'll get underway. Did any of you get a chance to watch the Ducks v Rampage games on the weekend?
Unfortunately not. Didn't want to see that.
No. Didn't watch the live streams? Didn't watch the highlights of the live streams?
Great, yeah. I'll have to go find this somewhere.
I didn't hear a word of that, but I'm sure it was good, whatever it was. The games are all recorded and you can watch them on YouTube. Just search for Pacific Hockey League. And you guys also know that all of your games are recorded, hopefully, and they're really valuable to watch. You can, apart from the time dilation that happens, everything on them looks really slow. Not only because you guys are really slow, but it's even worse because the camera angle flattens everything out. So it makes it look even slower than it would otherwise be. Camera angle down at ice surface makes everything look fast. Down it from an angle makes everything look really slow. Even the A graders look dreadfully slow when they use it. But the Pacific has proper camera crews around the rink. So you actually get some really good footage as well as the goal cameras and that sort of stuff too. So it's pretty good. Anyway, we're just about ready to get going. So the topic for this evening is mostly for wingers and centers, although it is valuable for defensive players if you want to listen into this as well. And if you're a center, you'll be doing a lot more and kind of picking up. There's a fair bit of overlap between the two. So really what the two things I want to go through with you this evening is obviously is how to score goals against structured defense is one of them. And the second one is just a little bit of management of face-off. So the face-off things is more about what to do when the puck gets dropped. For centers, you have a defined role, and wingers, you've got places to go to. And that's very context sensitive, depending where you are on the rink. So we'll go through that a little bit later. But the first thing is we're going to talk a little bit about how it is that we score goals against organized defenses. So how do we score a goal against an organized defense? I'm just going to sit here and listen.
Create chaos.
Yeah, create chaos. It's even there in the title. I can't make it any simpler. How do you create chaos? There's actually another way too. How many of you are Star Trek fan? Anyone here? Anyone Star Trek fan?
Yeah.
Yeah, who's a Star Trek fan? So, Ben, you're the Star Trek fan, yeah? How did Kirk beat the computer system to get admission into the Star Trek Academy?
What, break the rules?
Yeah, he broke the rules, didn't he? But how did he break the rules?
Go early.
Say again?
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, come on, I thought you were a Star Trek fan.
No, I accident, didn't he? Go early.
Okay, so how do you break an organized defense? You don't let there be one in the first place.
Yeah, that's it.
So how do you make sure there isn't an organ? So that means we've really got two contexts, haven't we? And this is a common recurring theme throughout everything that we do with all of the coaching that the development program is trying to instill into you guys as an attacking unit and also a defensive unit. The two dangerous things are disorganized defense, isn't it? You're not even letting a defense get organized in the first place. That's Kirk, right? Breaking the defensive pattern, but not even letting it get there in the first place. He's cheating. And the other one? How do you get a loose player in the slot?
You distract the other team, of course, and
you create chaos. You distract the defense. How do you distract the defense?
That I'm not sure about.
Movement.
Pretty simple, isn't it? You move. Because what do people do when they see movement?
They go towards it.
And they watch it. So they don't see what's happening behind them. Centers, what are you supposed to be doing all the time?
Moving.
Yeah, moving what?
Your head.
Putting your head around, watching what the hell's going on. But what happens when something distracts you? And you see movement and puck and so forth. What do you end up, what are we doing?
Look towards it.
We get focused on this thing. So if we as an attacking group can maintain motion all the time, we're much more likely to get movement. So I'm going to show you guys a video. Is this the one? Yeah, this is the one, I think. Yep, here we go. I'm just going to share a video with you. Now, if you're a center and you watched this last week, you'll be familiar with this video. And Kenny, I think you might have already seen it because I think you were here watching it last week as well. It's kind of funny when we say here when it's a Zoom session, but we're all used to that now.
Yeah.
All right. So we're going to watch this video. And we're going to, first of all, watch it in real time and then we'll slow it down. Looks like a pretty well organized defense, doesn't it? Oops. It was looking pretty good for a while, wasn't it? And then it wasn't. And how did they do it? Let's watch it again. We're just going to slow it down a little bit. So there's the puck behind the net. What do we teach our defensive players and centers ideally not to do?
Don't go behind the net.
Please don't go behind the net. Now, there are times when you might, but as a general philosophy, certainly what we're teaching you through our program is don't. Okay, but here we've got two. Let's see can you see my mouse there moving around?
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got two of those. I think it's the Leafs, isn't it? Anyway, they're not a great defensive team. Two of them behind the net. That's already a bit of a vulnerability, but it's not disastrous because Bruins only have four players down in the area at the time. Let's see what happens. Okay, so we've got one paired up. That's not bad. This player here looks like they're going out to look after the point. That's okay. And this one seems to have this one fairly well covered, don't they? That's pretty well organized, isn't it? And this other defensive player right here is marking that one. That's all looking pretty good. That's not a bad structure. If you were coaching that, you'd be thinking, yep, this looks good. I like it. They're not going to score a goal here because we've got them all covered. Even this one here is still being looked after, isn't it? Okay, so it all looks pretty good. We've got a good structured defense. It's not necessarily the way we would want you to structure, but it's a good structured defense. Now watch the creation of chaos. Still looks pretty good, doesn't it? Would you agree? Yeah, pretty much everyone's marked up. Everyone's covered. All looks pretty good. Now, this pixelation thing is a bit annoying. I'm not quite sure why it's doing it. Now what's happened? Sorry, apologies for that sort of smudge. I'll try and rewind it and see if I can get through to there without that happening. That's better. Now what's happening?
That guy who was marking the slot is now watching the puck instead of his player.
Yeah, see this here? What are they all looking at?
Yeah, all watching the guy with the puck.
Yeah, why?
Because it's movement.
Yeah, it's moving. He's got the puck and he's moving. He's moving around and around in circles and he's a threat. Like, it's dangerous. Even though, really, look, he's behind the net. He can't score from there. What's this? What's happening with this Bruin here?
Can we score?
Well,
he's going to pass it to
him. Well, look at it. Well, you're not going to pass to him yet, are you?
What's the loose player?
Well, he's going to be, isn't he? Because this player's no longer watching anymore, is he? This one's still got to watch that. This one's still got to watch that. These guys are tied up. All right, we've now got a loose defensive player not doing anything useful and another defensive player not watching this one. So we've got three players watching one because of movement. See the problem? Someone's going to say they can see.
I've passed the mate, but he's in the right spot.
He's got a lecture. This is an interactive thing, yeah? So keep your microphones on it. And
well, yeah, it's more than one.
All right. Now what's going to happen?
He's going to pass it to the guy in the face-off circle.
In the most dangerous place of all. Free player in the slot. Yeah. Da-da-da-da. Bang, bang, goal. Bang, bang, goal. And that happened just because of movement. What started out as a well-organized defense, they broke because they kept moving. Now, you need to be able to control the puck when you're doing that. And that does help. So being able to sort of skate round and round in circles while holding the puck has some value. And just passing the puck around is valuable as well, especially in C2. You'll find that the vast majority of D aren't particularly good at intercepting a pass. But also, unfortunately, the vast majority of C2 wingers aren't particularly good at passing either. So that's a skill that we need to work on. But as you get better at it, it'll become more dangerous. But the key there was they broke up a structured defense by movement. And that works across the board in any level of hockey. It doesn't matter what grade you're playing. This is, you know, NHL, the best players in the world. And you can watch that occur. You can watch it. As soon as you get a loose player in the slot because there's been movement and distraction, then that happens. Now, we can kind of look at that slowly and analyze that and say, well, look, that was pretty easy to see that coming. And yeah, why didn't they see that? But let's watch it again in real time. See how fast it happens. Pretty quick, isn't it?
Yeah, 7 seconds from when the guy behind the goal got the puck till they scored.
So the key to it was Charlie Coyle, this guy here that we're looking at who's just scored the goal, Bruin, by the way. What he's said is he's got away from this pressure. He's been covered. And he's moved. He turns away from that pressure and gets himself into the slot and then just waits. And no one covers him. And that's the critical part of this. So the control down here and the distraction combined with, see him circling away? Right? And now he sees there's this big chunk of empty space right where he wants to be. Happy times for me, matey. And then he goes, oh, look, there's no one there. Now I am. Tap, tap, tap. Pass to me, please. And bang. And that's all she wrote. You got one of them on yesterday, Ben. Was it yesterday? No, Sunday. Have you watched the video of it?
No, I didn't. Got close.
You did. You got real close. Right. You got an absolute free unmarked spot in front of the slot, which was a great opportunity. Both teams played particularly well on Sunday. Now, I have to say that because I'm coaching both of you, but at the same time, also did. Makes my job easier. I don't have to lie to you. So it's that movement creating chaos against a structured defense. So as we pointed out earlier and we kind of discussed a little bit, the two things to create chaos in a defensive structure is one, movement, and the second thing is not to let it get structured in the first place by having an odd player rush. And the odd player rush is key. So I'm going to show you another video. We're going to do a lot of these little things and just kind of go through them and look at what happened and see, because these things apply to us as well. They're just happening faster. This particular video is from one of the Pro League games earlier this year. I don't know if any of you got along to see any of them, but they were really good too. They'll be playing again next summer. Come along and watch. The Pro League games are free. I mean, you're nuts if you don't come and watch it. It's great hockey. You want to learn, you want to watch this stuff. And that was live streamed as well. So I'll share this too. So you've got so many opportunities now. When I started playing, there was none of this. We had nothing. We had a couple of coaches who didn't know what the hell they were doing. And honestly, that was it. So we're going to watch this one in real time. This is from the Pro League at iceHQ earlier this year, and it's the CCM Dogs against the Elwood Snipers. The CCM Dogs are in the black, and the Snipers are in the blue. Let's watch what happens in real time first, and then we'll pull it to bits. Now, we don't get the slow motion in this one, unfortunately, and the video isn't quite as good. We're doing testing of all the equipment. But two things of interest. First thing, what's happening here in this left-hand corner?
You got a defender going in to make a tackle on an attack.
What's going on here?
Pinching.
Yeah, pinching. What do we tell you guys before every single game? Don't pinch. What happens here? Pinch. What happens?
It's passing.
Yeah, it's passing. They always do. Well, I mean, you might save 20% of them, but 80% are going to get through. So bad odds. Don't like them. That's my annotator going, come back here, please. Go away with that. Unfortunately, with Zoom, you can't annotate at the same time as have videos running. It's really annoying. But we'll kind of go through this a little bit. Now, the other thing to look at is not only do we have the pinch, but we've also got a winger on the other side, not quite doing what we teach because it's Jamie Burke and he's a little bit more unstructured. But not, what would we normally have a winger doing in this situation on a breakout?
It should be closed.
Yeah, the winger, what we teach is the winger should be doing this. I'm going to go to a different color so you can see it. Should be kind of doing that and then this. Yeah?
Yep.
Yeah? Hopefully you remember. I've shown you enough times. Hopefully it's starting to sink in. Now, Jamie doesn't do that because it will be running into this traffic. And also it happens to be Adam Vajasov, who has a really, really good pass. Much better pass than any of you. Right? What Jamie's going to do, he's actually going to do this. Okay, so he's getting past these two players here. That's what he's thinking about doing. And he can see that Vajasov is going to get past this guy, and then he's going to go for him that way. Yeah, let's watch it happen again. Stupid annotator, they weren't going to push buttons. All right, so Vajasov beats the pinch. There's Berkey going down the other side. See him? And what's this D doing?
Trying to intercept.
Sorry?
He's trying to intercept.
He's trying to
intercept the pass.
What should he be doing?
Getting back.
Where's he be going back? Obviously, and he is. But what should he be doing positionally? Where does it look like he's going at the moment?
Looks like he's trying to cut off that player with the puck.
It does, doesn't it? Looks like he's going towards Vajasov. Why? Who would do that? That's dumb. What do we teach you?
How are you going to get it?
Get back into position, don't we? Is he going to beat Vajasov? Not a snowball's chance in hell. It's Adam Vajasov. You're not going to beat him, but you can get in position and wait for him. Let's watch what happens. Oops, he comes over and challenges, and then what happens? Gets even worse. Right, but look where he is when that happens. He's not going down the middle and occupying that territory, is he? He's come across to Vajasov, freeing up the player behind him in Burke. And if you give Burke a free run at the net, he's going to score. So that's an example of that rush getting through a pinching defense. Now, no matter how much we teach our defense not to do it, and no matter how much we teach our centers not to do it, still they are going to pinch sometimes. When they think they've got a chance, they're going to pinch. It's an instinct. It's almost impossible to unlearn. That's why we hammer it so hard. We repeat it every time. Because every now and then they actually get it right, and then this doesn't work. But if you can do it, you're getting an unstructured defense to play against, and that's a fantastic opportunity. And you've all done it already. I think pretty much everyone here has had an opportunity to get one of those odd player breaks, haven't you? I don't think there's anyone here who hasn't at least seen it in front of them and thought, I'm clear. You might not have had the speed or the skill to take advantage of it, but the opportunity was there. And that's what we're trying to create. Yeah. Let's watch it again, just because it's Berkey scoring a goal. And I love watching Berkey score goals. You know it anywhere near him. In it goes. Party time for Jamie Burke. He scored like 5 goals that day or something insane. He made it look easy. It wasn't, but he made it look easy. And the goalie there, Tommy Forrest, is actually playing for the Ducks now. He's pretty damn good, but he made him look silly. All right, so you can see how that happens and how it's the winger from the other side coming across and providing that option and that pass that made that goal happen. It wasn't Vajasov. Vajasov set it off, but Jamie got in position to receive it. And that's the thing. And that's why the offside winger, what you do, and you've got to, it's not just stand still and wait for things to happen. You've got to be moving all the time. Even on defense, because that way you create these breaks and you do the, you can call it the Captain Kirk if you like. You're right with that, Ben? So let's have a look at some other chaos, see what we can find. I've got a bunch of videos that are kind of prepared already for this, which will hopefully make sense. One. It's a dirty rebound. Let's look at some rebounds instead, because I'm a big one for rebounds. The other thing we teach you guys is crash the net, isn't it? Yeah. Big key, crash the net. Get in the slot. I'm going to show you something from the day before's game between the Ducks and the Rampage. And sorry about the noise in the background. I've got to kind of fast forward through this till we get to the right bit. National anthem, let's get that. I'm on a computer, catch up.
Against a good pressure there for the Ducks winning those face-offs too. That was a nice positive win from the opening.
I'm going to stream this so you can kind of see it. And we'll pause it when it gets to the right point. That's when we'll stop and have a look so you can, again, kind of see what's going on with this. I didn't want to download the entire 2.5 hours of video so I could edit it. It was a bit too much. So I'm just going to show it to you like this because it's fairly hectic. Yeah, it's like 2.5 gigabytes. But I apologize for the commentary. If you don't like it, bad luck.
Face off with the mad good control. I do love seeing Teddy Carpenter when he gets back. He's always got a big grin on his face. He just loves playing this game.
Webster had a great game in the faceoff dot yesterday, and he's continued that so far early in the first. So another faceoff win, gets it back to Stringer, who takes a shot, rebound, squirts out into the neutral zone, and Stringer, who's back into his normal position of defense today, collects the puck. That was chip there to Shuma, who looked for Webster, but just out of the reach, allowing Brisbane to dump that deep, and covered up by Dane with a little awkward bounce off the back wall.
Yeah, good safe play there. Good to see Byron Shuma getting on nice and early as well. He was underplayed possibly a little bit in the games against the Avalanche, but he's not going to be underplayed today. I think he's going to get lots of ice time.
So,
and we'll see a lot of creativity from him.
Hopefully we'll get the right camera angle. I just want to pause this too if we get a chance.
Hector facing off against Josh Anderson. Officials just having a quick chat, and they're ready to drop the puck. So here we go. Face off to the left of Dane David.
Now, I just want you guys to see the face-off setup. Does that look familiar? It had better.
Yes.
Isn't that what we teach? What have we got here? That's our standard defensive face-off, isn't it? Who knew? Right? We're not just making this shit up, but actually, see, for a reason. So you've got this guy who's going to go like that. This one who's probably going to go up there. This one's tying up that. The D is sitting here, and he's going to go across around the back or something along those lines and pick up the mess if it comes out messily. Right? Exactly the same thing that we teach. Remember it this time, yeah? The drop of the puck. Where's he going? Straight across. Yeah? I remember. I'll do it. Yeah, of course. All right, let's see.
So face off one.
See? Yeah. Nods. Yeah.
We said Wingham was like a bit back to Wingham now, but
yeah. Sorry, you're a bit quiet.
I think it looks like the weak side wing is a bit further back than we normally have them.
No, that's the D. I think you're referring to
it might be the angle, right?
Yeah, so you've got this wing has gone up. I can't really wind it back in this. I don't have the ability to shuffle backwards and forwards with YouTube videos on the stream. It just was kind of an opportunistic thing to show you. But you can see how this guy's just come barreling straight through, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Straight away putting pressure here. Happy times. That's what we do. That's what we teach. So on the drop of the puck, move your ass. Don't sit there and look at it. Go first, yeah? Then you can think afterwards. Let's watch what happens now.
Another rampage, subject, ship side deep for Smith to collect.
So what's happened there is they've actually got a turnaround. He was under pressure. They'd won the face-off. Rampage had won the face-off. But the D did not get clean possession because he had two players barreling straight at him. He's like, oh, what do I do? All I can do is dump into the corner because there's no other options. Yeah, which provides the opportunity for a nice organized breakout.
So we're able to poke that
ish, eventually.
So Hector Brolnick behind his own net passes it over to Carpenter. Carpenter, cross ice pass for Cutter. But
bad pass. I wouldn't do that.
To go back and collect. Poke check there by Subcheck. Over to Adler. The puck gets back. Pinned up here on the point. So here's Carpenter with a shot. Blocker saved there by Novi Sedlak. Hector Brolnick leaves the puck there for Stringer. Puck taken off his stick by Subcheck. So here comes Subcheck with speed over the blue line. Over, protects it, pass it in front, pucks into the slot. Connor.
Were Ducks lucky there?
Yeah.
They weren't they? They had an unmarked rampage player in the slot and another one loose in the slot, and he was just a bit unlucky that he didn't get the right rebound. So they're a bit lucky there, weren't they?
You can say yes, because they were.
A great job by Cutter. Adler now the shot blocked there by Dixon. And that was a great little stick check there by Cutter. That's for sure. That was a real smart play, right? He's looking for a pass into the slot, but doesn't see one. So throws it right onto the stick of Dane Davis, who was forced to make that save. And if it were for Cutter lifting the stick of Connor there, could have been another early rampage goal.
But this time the Ducks were alert to it. But you can see every time Subcheck gets anywhere near it, it's just that danger, and we've got to really cut it off early.
That's for sure. So here's McDonough, the captain. He passes out from the back end over to Gallagher. Nice job by Anderson, able to collect that from Gallagher.
Now, sometimes we get the puck tangled up in our feet. We're not quite sure where it is. So do they. They recover a bit quicker, but the same thing happens.
Puck, he's over the blue line.
Good organized defense there, yeah?
Just goes wide. Webster tries to set it in front, but nobody said that was to the task. Now Cutter sends it over to Gallagher. Gallagher across for Webster, but out of his reach, allowing Jones for the Briar Page to collect. So Jones battling with Webster. Webster comes out with it in the front to Gallagher. Another save by Novi Sedlak. So a couple of great A scoring chances for the Ducks, but they're not able to solve Novi Sedlak. And here comes the rampage through McTaggart. So McTaggart just stops there on the half wall, looked across over for Jones, but Gallagher sends that deep in the corner for Leo to collect. This is pinned out here for the rampage, and Leo drills over Anderson.
We're not allowed to do that.
Coming across the blue line. Shot blocked there by the rampage defender. And Gallagher will send that deep and peel off for a change.
That was Rubble making that big check on the boards. We needed to do it too. It's been all Ducks so far with 7 shots on in the first 4 minutes.
So here's Anderson now, collects it and shoots the puck high off the glass and into the netting. We'll have a face-off in the defensive zone for the rampage.
This is a different game today.
Yeah, here's that play that we were talking about, right?
Yeah.
That play, just to throw it on net, right? As a goalie, look, Dane has no choice but to send that out in front. But Cutter did a really good job of blocking that.
Bucks also not getting numbers this time. They need to be.
So here's Dixon now, sends it through the crease, but there was no duck there to tap it in. So reverse back to...
See a problem? If you're the rampage, do you see the problem?
No, Ducks players rampage players sort of there, but not quite.
Mm.
Yeah.
The Ducks got a loose player in the slot, haven't they?
Dixon now coming out of from behind the net. He curls.
So what happened? This guy came across and lifted his stick and moved him out of the way, didn't he? Which is exactly the right thing to do. He did good. That was a good move. Ruddle had to move then because he was covered. But he was there initially. That's what they're going to keep trying to set up. They're trying to get that loose player on the previous day. They hadn't been doing it. They weren't getting in the slot. They missed a lot of rebounds because this goalie, he's pretty good, but he gives rebounds up.
Nice job to stay away from Bale.
There he is again. See the problem?
He sends that back for Cutter. Cutter now with it on the forehand, gets laid out by Bale. Puck comes through for Vrilnik in the far corner. Vrilnik looking in front. Dixon shots at Carpenter. Shot through. Oh, and what a glove save by Novi Sedlak.
So some good opportunities there, isn't there? That player floating around in the slot. They're trying to get it into them. They're trying to get those rebounds. Let's watch this for a couple more minutes and see what happens.
He was forced to reach out there and snare that out of the air.
This big shot there at that point lined it up well. It was a beautiful shot here. This is a very different game so far, but in every time the Ducks kind of
play. How close was that? Right, and why did that happen? Ronald was sitting there essentially unmarked because they got there because of movement. The Rampage had a good organized defense, but the movement brought them out of position, and it's that movement creating chaos.
You get complacent every time the Rampage do get those right positions.
I two mean, bites didn't go in.
Here's Carpenter now looking for Ronald, or for Cutter, sorry. Cutter will collect it in the far corner now. Curls, walks through to the slot, drops it for Bennett. He'll take a slapper with Sands on it. This will allow Connor for the Rampage to collect, and he'll exit the zone. So Connor now for the Rampage over the red line. He dumps that into the corner and curls back. Bennett for the now whips it around the corner, but Bale is there for the Rampage. Just mishandles it, allowing Webster to collect. Webster's 1-on-3. He's got Carpenter coming in with him, so he stops. Sends it over to Carpenter, but a great stick there by Bale to the gate. Carpenter being able to collect it. So Carpenter deep into the zone now, pinching. He's got it behind the Rampage net. He's got on the forehand, looking for Ruddle. Puck squirts, and Novi Sedlak puts the glove blocker down and covers that up.
Now, in case you're curious, there was a drinking game going on apparently on people who were watching the live stream saying every time Gossie said squirts, they'd have to have a drink. I think everyone ended up very drunk. Because he says a lot.
I've heard, Anton, there's a drinking game going on for people watching the commentary every time.
Oh, there it is.
You have to make yourself conscious or anything.
Yeah. There's always one every game.
There's always one every game.
During this game, there was one yesterday. There's corrals, collects the puck. I think I saw that a million times yesterday.
It's all good. We'll maintain essence of humor, that's for sure. There's a good little stanza there, good opportunities on the net. Lots of shots coming. Ducks up to 9 shots on the net so far. That'll be 10 in the first 5 minutes.
So Webster's battling behind the net. Gallagher goes in to collect it. Gallagher is going to look to pass that up to the point, but he's being checked by 2 Rampage. The Ducks still with the puck, though, but now finally Sobchak will collect and take that behind the net. So here's Sobchak for the Rampage now. He looks for a pass, looking for his teammate in Anderson.
The goal will happen.
Able to collect it and allowing the McMahon for the Ducks to select that and then send it over to Springer. He looks for Gallagher, intercepted by Sobchak. Sobchak, danger, shot, save, rebound, oh, pass him home, but Gallagher lifts the...
See what happened there? Another loose player in the slot. You just got to get there. Now, McTaggart missed it, but he was there. And if it had a bounce right, that would have gone in for them because there was no way Davis was going to stop that.
Take a Smith and stops what would have been a great opportunity out of gaping cage. So here's McMahon now. Ducks doing a great job of defending and forechecking and having that back check by the forwards.
Actually, they were lucky.
Very apparent. Nobody said that. Nearly has a tumble there. But leaves it for Jones, who sends it up to Vrilnik. He's got Dixon.
See the problem?
Oh, I'm playing the slot again.
Ruddle, he's there all the time, isn't he? Just about every single attacking opportunity the Ducks have got. Ryan Ruddle is sitting there quite often unmarked in the slot. What's this guy doing?
Huh? Every time. In that whole game.
Get in his face. Get in his face. You were watching it, weren't you, Jess?
Yeah, I was.
Why do you think Ruddle scored?
Was it him? Goals? It was him at the 3, yeah?
Yeah.
Or was it
that
three,
that three.
Yeah.
Looks in front, pass shot. That just goes into the corner. Vrilnik will collect.
Now, let's watch it slowly here.
His own rebound.
Look at Ruddle. Who's on him?
Out in the far corner. He cuts into the middle. Lines. What a great stick by Anderson. Back in now. Shot scores!
Look at where he is. There's no one on him. Now, it was a lucky opportunity because it was a rebound off the goalie and he hadn't closed his pad, so all Ruddle did was smack it in. But let's watch it and see what happened.
watch that on the replay. You can see it's those dirty goals in the front. You get the shot on, you get the rebound. And all those adult beginners that we work with, they be telling crash the net. And that's why. It's a great initial save, but the puck bobbles around.
See? He can't lift from there, can he? He's covered by the goalie. All he does is just bang it in and hope. What's Subcheck doing back here? Does he think he's a goalie? Where should he be? He should be. Subcheck should be. And we've got about 5 minutes to go. And when this thing goes, it's just going to shut down blindly and we won't restart it. So you know where he should be. He should be here. It's not a goalie. What the? It's stupid. Yeah.
They did that a few times during both of their games, actually.
He's trying to be everything for that team. Goalie, coach, goal scorer, defense, the works. He tries to do everything. He's almost good enough to get away with it.
So if he was to rush in...
He shouldn't be there in the first place.
Yeah.
right? He should have been marking... They should know Ruddle, because when they last played against him, Ruddle scored 5 points and 3 goals in exactly the same way. He gets in the slot, moves around, gets space because he just keeps moving, or they're not even watching him for some reason. Like, why aren't you watching this guy? He scores goals all the bloody time. Yeah, watch him. Watch this guy. Yeah. And all he has to do here
is just find a hole and shove it through.
So find a hole and shove it through.
It's following the score. Right. 10 shots for a goal. But every time Subcheck gets it, you've got to watch out the rest.
Watch the rest of the game. There's a lot of that. But the point is, it's that movement and that chaos that takes an organized, structured defense and disrupts it. Now, we've got about 3 minutes left before Zoom is going to shut us down, and it's just going to shut down hard. So we haven't really looked very much at face-offs, apart from kind of looking at some defensive face-offs. We'll probably have a look at that week after next, or maybe next week. We might go through a bit more stuff on face-offs. As I think that's a...
Coach Jeremy video was really good. I watched that earlier today.
Which one?
The Coach Jeremy face-off.
Yeah, Jeremy. That
was really good.
What he does, though, is he tends to overcomplicate things a little bit. Don't get me wrong, I love his stuff. It's brilliant. And once you kind of have been playing for a year or two, you can watch and think, oh, this is just full of gold. But you can easily get obsessed by some of the minutiae and miss out on the big picture stuff with his stuff sometimes. And I think it's because he's been doing it for so long. He kind of thinks that everyone has progressed. And he forgets about the people that are just starting off. So that's why we boil it right down and keep it really, really simple. Like he's got these multi-pages, and I used to hand them out for how to play each position, but there's too much detail in it. And you get, you just get paralyzed by there's so many things I have to try and remember. And really, we want to keep it really simple and not get confused on it. Like I've got books here, like with hundreds of hockey players. But honestly, if we tried to learn more than two of them, you guys aren't going to remember. We want to get one or two of them right. So hopefully that's been of value. Just kind of seeing those things and seeing how movement disrupts and how also the plays that we're using in C2 are being used at this level and at an NHL level. It's the same basic thing, the same basic structures. They just do it faster and with better passes and so forth. But the gist of it is the same. And as we pointed out, it was pointed out right at the very start, the way you break up a structured defense is movement. Just keep moving. Sooner or later, someone will get distracted. Sooner rather than later in C2. Everyone starts puck chasing. And you can see it. It's like watching 5-year-olds playing soccer. Everyone's on the ball.